Okay, so we're going to go ahead and start. Good evening, everyone. Brief announcements. Let's see, the Zool Lab, I know you started on it.
Yes, I've had so much fun with it so far.
Yeah, it's a fun lab. And I remember that the midterm is coming up, which I mentioned in the remind messages as well. Not this coming week, the following week. Okay, so what we're going to do now is start on the lecture and then maybe do the key or in between the two chapters. Okay, so so this chapter is about library classes and all the wonderful things that they can enable us to do easily. The official title is More Sophisticated Behavior, Using Library Classes to Implement Some More Advanced Functionality, and it's Chapter 6, the newest version of the book.
One side note, I went in to watch the videos for Chapter 8, and it spoke of nothing about Zool and Project Zool and the other thing, which was...
But you went through the ones through the link in your book to the new ones?
No.
No. Right. So the old ones use the old numbers. So the old numbering system, I believe, is Chapter 6.
Ah.
I'd like to know if there's anything new in your videos or if there's something new. But anyway, okay. So, one of the things that makes the Java class libraries so useful is not merely that they're extensive. There's probably actually tens of thousands of classes and hundreds of thousands of methods. But it's that they're very thoroughly documented. I don't know why we have documented, had that on another slide. Very thoroughly documented in HTML format that's readable in a web browser. we should mention that what is documented is what is sometimes called an API or application programmer interface, is what API stood for. The term is now used generically, whether it's an application or not. This was actually a term used by older versions of Windows and some other operating systems. Interface or API is the interface to something. We'll talk more about what that means in a bit and have before as well. So the class documentation contains interface descriptions for all the library classes. This screenshot is from an older browser, as well as an older version of the documentation. It's an example page about string. The newer pages look much nicer, but still contain information on the packages, the particular packages that is in, the classes, which classes are contained within packages, and then a list of all the publicly visible fields, if any, which is generally going to be constants, like here, and all the constructors and other methods of the class. In this case, this is for the class string. So we can see some different constructors of string. We can make a string from nothing. We can make a string from a byte array that interprets it in a platform dependent way. We can make a string from several other things farther down below here that we don't actually see. a lot of the classes actually have at the very top a short textual summary of how to use the class and oftentimes even some example code. So, very well documented. Let's see. Let's just look real quick and see what. This is our Java version 7, which 8 is now the most recent version. String, descends from object, interfaces and implements, text and some example code using it, and some notes on various interesting and useful things about strings, and then the fields, and then let's see, what have we got, probably around 15 constructors there, and three dozen methods. So concat, for example, accepts a string and concatenates the specified string to the end of the existing string, returning a new string. So very nicely documented. Extensive. So there's Java class libraries for lots and lots and lots of things. Many common things. There is some sort of class library to help you do. So let's talk a little bit about interface versus implementation. So the documentation of the class includes the name of the class, the general description of the class, list of constructors and methods, return values and parameters for methods and parameters for constructors, a description of the purpose of each constructor and method. These things are the interface of the class, aka API in usage. Here are some things the documentation doesn't include: private fields, which most fields are private, private methods, and the source code of the methods. All of these things are parts of the implementation of the class. So, documentation describes interface in detail. It generally does not say anything about the implementation, which is quite deliberate. Does that make sense? One other thing we should note, which did come up in 1312, I believe, as well. So the documentation includes parameterized classes. The documentation includes provision for a type parameter like array list of E. These type names reappear in the parameter return types, returns E, and accepts something of type E, named E. And so what this means here is an element type. But in general, whatever letter they use, the type in the documentation is a placeholder for the type that we're going to use in practice. So array list of ticket machine has ticket machine get int index. And boolean add accepts a ticket machine named whatever. Does that make sense? So they had to have some name for the parameterized type in the documentation, and what they did was choose single letter names reflective of the meaning in order to make it clear perhaps that these are different than the parameters. Any questions about that? Not yet. Okay. So, some other concepts we're going to talk about. Some more library classes. We're not going to talk about ArrayList much in here, because we've used it in the past. We'll this class and prior classes. And we're going to talk a little bit about writing documentation in Java Doc. So set and map are two types that are worth knowing about. But before we talk about the Java set collection type, we should talk about what is a set. Any idea?
My rudimentary understanding of a set is just a grouping of objects without any particular order.
Okay. Pretty good. A set is irrespective of order. That's true. It's a collection of items. It's irrespective of order. It is also the case that any given item either appears in the set or does not appear in the set. So the set never contains two bears. It either contains a bear or it does not contain a bear. So storing each individual item at once contains the item or does not, and there's no defined order. Order is not important in a set. When we write it out, we'll take some order when we write them out, but that order doesn't really matter. So some examples of sets, using the mathematical notation. Here, the set A contains tiger, lion, puma, cheetah, leopard, cougar, and ocelot. And semantically, this is a set of large species of cats. But the order doesn't matter whether ocelot is first or tiger is first. We can list them whichever way it's sort of random. The question is just, is tiger in the set or not? Is lion in the set or not? Is jaguar in the set or not? The answer is no, jaguar is not in the set, not large enough either. Another example, the set A contains A, B, C, etc., all the way through Z. This is a set of the lowercase letters of the alphabet. Third example, the set A contains 0 and 1. This is a set with the possible values for each digit in binary.
That's very small set.
Yeah. Well, but the smallest set is the null set contains 0 things. So. So. A set allows us to say, is something a member of it or not? And to add things to it to make them members of it. And if something is already in it and we try to add them to it, well, it doesn't make any difference, it's already in the set. So here's an example of using sets. So first of all, we have to import java.util.hashset to use this particular set implementation called hashset. From java.util, which is true for all the collection types we talked about in this chapter. Then we declare one, so we say hash set, and we say what is over, hash set over string, or hash set to contain strings, hash set parameterized to string, hash set of string, my set equals new hash set of string, and we'll give it any parameters, so it creates an empty set originally, and then we add 1, and 2, and 3, and then we could go through and do something with each of those elements. For example, ask it to give me an element, and I'll print it out, give me another element, I'll print it out, give me another element, I'll print it out. So it might give these back to us in any order in principle. One thing to notice here is this is exactly like the code for ArrayList. Except instead of hash set, we would write array list, and we would want to name this set, right? We want to use a better name reflecting the fact it's a list, but that doesn't matter to the compiler. So, by design, all of the collections share the same interface wherever possible, and that makes it really easy to switch between using the different Java collections. Sometimes you can just do something like change this and this, and that's it. Or maybe even if you used a more abstract type here, just change this. Any questions about that?
No.
Okay.
That's kind of like the similarities between golf and disc golf, the rules are, to my knowledge, basically identical, but the things used are different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the way you putt or something like that. Here's an example of using a set. Before we go through the code on this slide, I want to talk about what it's for. So sets give us a great way to break down what the user typed and check for keywords. So this is from the tech support system example. First we break it down and put the words in the set, and that's what all of this does. And then later on, we can just say, does the set of words from what the user typed contain by, for example? If it does, then we say, okay, glad we were helpful to you. Please contact us again when you have another problem, or whatever it is. Let's look at the code here that breaks it up and puts it in the set. Get input, we prompt the user, we get a line, we trim off spaces in the beginning or end, we make it all lowercase so that we're not case dependent. For the user type, we just recognize BYU no matter what case they use, even if they use camel case or something else. There's an operation on strings called split, which will chop up all the components of the string that are separated by some separator, in this case, things separated by spaces, and return an array of all of those things. So this gives us an array of all of the words in input line. We put that in word array, and then we make a hash set over a string called words, and then we walk through word array and add in the words to our hash set, and then we return our set, which we can then easily test and say, do you contain by, do you contain bug, do you contain whatever it is that our tech support system is looking for as a keyword. Does that make sense? Questions about that?
Not at this point.
Okay. That's sets, and of course there's more detail in the book. Another valuable collection type is a map. So whereas sets just contain individual items, maps contain pairs of values. And a pair consists of a key and a value. And then we can look something up in the map by supplying a key, and the map will give us the value. An example of a map is a telephone book. So if you think back to what telephone books used to be like, you would look up a person's name, say John Smith. That would be the key, and when you found their name and the right address for the right John Smith, let's say, then you would see off to the right their phone number, and you would call them. So, a map maps from a set of keys to a set of values. So, John Smith might map to the number 3 places it used 4-digit phone numbers within the local exchange. So here's an example of what a map would look like in Blue Jay in an address book. Blue Jay tells us this is a type hash map, And here are the three keys, the three names, and here are the three phone numbers. So Charles Nguyen, I believe that's how you pronounce that, has a phone number 531-9392-4587. That can be spelled NG or some other different ways, but as I understand it, they're all pronounced Nguyen. The hard thing is remembering what's how you pronounce it. Lisa Jones, for that key, there's the associated value 42-4536-4674, and William H. Smith, for that key, there's the associated value 998-5488-0123. So we have three different keys and three different values. One that each of the key one corresponding to each one of the keys. So here's some example code that creates that hash map and uses it. So, when we created the collection types that we saw before, we only supplied a single parameter type because they only worked on single values. But HashMap works on two kinds of things, a key and a value. So we have to supply two parameters, two type parameters, the type of the keys and the type of the values. So HashMap maps from strings to strings, name your phone book, and we say it's a new hash map from string to string. We can just use the plain diamond notation and not type out the type parameters here. Then phone book.put Charles Nguyen, and this number creates the entry Charles Nguyen. And phone book.put Lisa Jones, 42, and all of that creates the entry Lisa Jones, and then phone book.put William H. Smith, and that creates the entry William H. Smith. And then we could ask the phone book to give us the value associated with Lisa Jones, namely Lisa Jones's phone number, and print that out. And so you see how trivial it is to implement a phone book if you have a collection that behaves like this, right? Because a collection essentially does all the work, in this case at least, and you just are sort of providing a little bit of wrapper on top of it.
Okay,
question?
Yes.
Question,
sorry. I see where the hash map was given the name of phone book.
Uh-huh.
And we're asking, with a call on get from the key of Lisa Jones, we tell the system to println the value of the phone number. So, but I don't see where phone number was given as the type of value. Or is that just assuming?
So, when you say phone number was given as the type of value on this
map, right? Well, the hash map has, you know, when it's
what
initiated was.
What do you think it means to say that phone map is say that phone number is the type of value?
Well, the hash map created there was parameterized with two strings, one string being the key, and one, the next string being the value. And we know that for the entry where we put Lisa Jones for the key and the number associated with her as the value, but I don't see where the value was, the type of value was called or named phone number, so that
okay.
We know to return the value.
So phone book just maps from a string to a string.
Mm-hmm.
The convention we decided on was that the first string was going to represent the name of an individual, and the second string was going to represent a phone number.
Understood.
But this second string is, from Java's perspective, just a sequence of characters, right? So phonebook.get gives us a string.
Yes.
And then we call it by the name phone number, but Java couldn't care less whether we call it a phone number or we call it Rumpelstiltskin.
The code
works the same from this perspective. So phone number is just what we're calling it to remind ourselves that's what this string means. But it's not a type.
That's what my brain missed. String phone number equals phone book dot get Lisa Jones.
Yeah. And because phone number has these parentheses in here for the area code, and it doesn't behave exactly like an integer in some different ways, string happens to be a good way to represent.
Oh, right, yeah. I completely comprehend now. I was just missing, I don't know why my brain just completely blanked out where it said string phone number. I saw everywhere else, I saw phone book, but I missed phone number, except for where it was
called on the same in five letters. Yeah.
Hurry. Yeah. Okay, I totally understand.
Okay, any other questions? Okay, so.
Because when it calls on, when we called the get on Lisa Jones, it is by the nature of the hash map not going to return the key, it's going to return the value when we...
Right, because that's the definition of what get does. Get accepts a key and returns the corresponding value. We can imagine there's an inverse operation that says, find me who has this value, and that would give us the name, a sort of reverse lookup. I don't know if HashMap actually has that operation because it would be very expensive for it. But one could imagine that something like that exists. Let's talk a little more about the kinds of collections we've seen and what the collection names mean. So we've seen that Java collections give us some very handy ways to group objects other than just a plain array. They have some different implementations available. For example, list comes in array list and linked list. Hash set comes in hash set to tree set. But we saw that our examples of maps and sets both started with hash, even though clearly they behave very differently, right? So hash map is not the same as hash set, even though they both start with this HASH, whatever that means. So let's talk a little bit about what the collection names mean and how we decide them. The second word by the conventions used for the Java collection classes, the second word of the collection name tells us what kind of collection. Is it a list or a map or a set? So, reveals organizational relatedness or how they treat their contents, how they think about their contents, if you like. The first word actually tells us what underlying data structure is used to implement the list, map, or set. So, for example, you could implement all three of these, more or less, with an array or with a data structure called the hash table that we'll see in the data structures class, or with a data structure called the tree we'll see in the data structures class, or some other things. And the reason that Java mentions to us what the data structure underneath is shaped like makes that visible is because the different data structure shapes underneath have consequences for what things the collection can do efficiently and what things take longer. And so depending on what kind of operations we tend to use our set for example, might make us lean towards hash set versus tree set. But they all behave as like a set or map or list, whichever it is they are. But they will be more efficient in certain operations if we know enough to carefully choose the underlying data structure. And that's why Java reveals that. Does that make sense? But so the key thing to focus on for now is the second term, because that tells us how it behaves. It behaves like a list, it behaves like a set, it behaves like a map, whatever it is. That's what we care about now. Okay, so as I mentioned before, one of the things that makes the Java class libraries so useful is the extensive documentation. Now we're going to talk about how your classes should be documented when you write them. And essentially, your own classes should be documented the same way that library classes are, so that other people can use your class without reading the implementation to make your class, say, so to speak, a potential library class for other users. And in fact, this, while Oracle makes available a large and extensive set of class libraries, there are a lot of classes and class libraries made available by various other third parties by doing exactly this. So, whenever you write a class, document it thoroughly to make it a potential library class. Someday it may be. And also to help you remember and understand what it does and why you wrote it, so that when you come back 6 months, 6 months later, you'll see what this thing is rather than looking at it thinking, oh, I think it did this, and it turns out it does some other thing, and you waste time because of that. So let's talk about how to do that. So documentation for a class should include the name of the class, a comment describing the overall purpose and characteristics of the class, maybe a sentence, maybe a paragraph, maybe a couple paragraphs, maybe a version number, the names of the authors or author, and documentation for each constructor and for each method. The documentation for each constructor and each method should include the name of the method, return type, the parameter names and types, a description of the purpose and function of the method, description of each parameter, and a description of the value returned. And Java has this really nice tool built in called JavaDoc, which can extract these things from the comments in your code if you take care to set them up in a JavaDoc compliant way. And so this is the standard for how Java documentation works, and most of the better IDEs support this in some way. For example, they might be able to, if you cursor over or use the mouse pointer to highlight a given method of your class or someone else's class and press, say, F1, it might display for you the comment for the method and the comment for the parameters. Or if you pick a particular parameter, might be able to display the comment for that particular parameter, as well as the name of the parameter, which is very, very handy, right? How you format things to be JavaDoc compliant. With the class comment, you use a I think this is also true for method comments. You use a double star here to say that this is the beginning of the comment for this thing, and this is the beginning file, so this is comment for class. And then this text here is the sort of general comment for the class or method or object. At and one of the keywords like author, that says names of the authors is this, at version, the version is this, and you can add parameters with an at sign and
I saw that parameter when I was working with Zool.
Yeah. Okay, so here's a better example. Now they've actually here embedded HTML tags to sort of format it up a little. You don't necessarily need to do that. But so here, for example, on addNum, and they deliberately do a little overkill here. So we have the double star to say this is the beginning of the comment about the thing. This method is used to add to integers, the simplest form of a class method, just to show the usage of various Java tags. And we say at param num a. So for the first parameter is named num a, and the descriptive comment is this is the first parameter to add num method. Second at param num b. This is the second parameter to add num method, and you also can document the return value. So it's just a type int, and it returns the sum of num a and num b. Maybe they might have an example of the documentation actually generated from it.
What?
They do here. Okay. Okay. So here we've got this one for image. Oracle does use tags in it. So, get image, public image, get image, 60 URL, and string, returns an image object, can be painted on the string URL, you can specify an absolute, so that's these comments here, then we've got paragraph in this other little one, and then with each parameter, we've got the description of the parameter. Returns, and we also have a C also, so kind of a link within the documentation. And so as you can see, that makes that very nice and readable. And you can imagine, you know, browsing through that on a web page, just like the official documentation. And indeed, that is how the official documentation is generated, most of it. So. Very nicely designed thing after Java used it, some other languages have picked up something like Java is the first language I know of that standardized something like this, and it was good with me. Any questions about that?
Not yet.
Okay. Then, say what?
I was going to say, in the previous thing we were looking at, mm-hmm. in the web page, was that an example of?
I think I closed it.
That an example of Java doc that was pulled directly from the class comments from a class?
You mean, is that from the actual Java class libraries, or do you mean? Is that what Java doc generated from what we saw?
Right.
It is what Java doc generated from what we saw. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
So
it might be
we should be able to basically do that with our documentation.
Yeah. And so in BlueJ, so, I didn't actually realize you did this. So in BlueJ, I'm looking at one of these little bad classes, parser. We've got this little thing right here, mm-hmm. source code. We switch over to documentation, and voila, we see the documentation.
Cool.
And so let's see, game might be a good one to look at that on. Yeah. And the sort of hyperlinks them in, so it'll take you down.
What do those hyperlinks do?
It just takes you
to the documentation for that?
Yes. Yes. Now, if you created a hyperlink that went somewhere else, it would go to the other place. Like with Get Image, there is a hyperlink for C image.
Are the hyperlinks auto-generated, or do you create them in the content?
It depends. So these ones we're seeing here are automatically generated.
Mm-hmm. Or is that where the at, and where it follows the at sign in the documentation, does that?
Let me see. So like this at C image, it automatically finds where the class image is defined within how to talk about it within this Java program.
So if we forget to use the at, say at param or at parameter, our documentation will be devoid of clickable links.
Well, so you would still get like this and this. You wouldn't get this one. And this was supposed to be a link here, but it's broken. Not sure why. But up here they wrote add link URL. I guess it's because they didn't actually give a URL. Mm. No, actually no.
Well, there's one.
That shouldn't have caused that to break there, because you can see that, you know, it does work there. Yeah. 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 Which is why they go on to say we developed a document checking tool. Yeah, so good question. Yes. It generates the vast majority of links using automatic, but if you want to add additional ones, there's a syntax for that. Yep. Any other questions about chapter 6? Okay. Then let's see. We are now getting to the heart of this course, how to design classes in OO software systems well. And that's what chapter 8 in current edition textbook is about. So chapter 8, designing classes. How to write classes such that they're easily understandable, maintainable, and reusable. And the main concepts we'll talk about are responsibility-driven design, which is essentially designing classes by assigning a well-defined responsibility to each class. Coupling, which is the degree of interrelationship between different things. Cohesion, which is the extent to which something is a single integral thing. I'll try to give some examples in a bit. And basically, coupling bad, cohesion good, for good or design. And we'll also talk about refactoring, which is updating the design of something while the code has already been fully implemented or partway through the implementation. So, one key thing to know is that software changes. it's not like a novel that's written once and then remains unchanged. Software is extended, corrected, maintained, ported, adapted, and other things. And this work, and maybe even the original creation, are done by different people over time. And in total, this generally stretches over decades. In fact, actually, the vast majority of the cost of a software system is not the initial development, it's actually the maintenance after the initial development, something like 80%. So there's really only two options for software. Either it's continuously maintained or it dies. It may not be obvious that it would die if it wasn't continuously maintained. But software experiences a curious phenomenon known informally as bit rot, where essentially it stops working because of changes in the world around it. Let's say in terms of these other software that it interacts with, and also possibly regulatory or policy changes and other things that change, and if it doesn't change with them, it becomes increasingly non-useful. So if you try to, even though Microsoft has tried very hard to maintain compatibility of old applications, if you were to try to run something for Windows 95, which is near 20 years ago, there's no way.
Mm-hmm.
You probably could even run something for NT4, which is essentially what the current Windows is based on, rather than the Windows 95 line. So software that can't be maintained will be thrown away. So it's very important to make it maintainable. And as we've already mentioned, every chapter has at least one motivating example application. In this chapter, it's an interesting little thing, essentially a game of a clone of the game called Adventure. It was one of the, perhaps the first text-based game back in the late 70s, I want to say, or early 70s, perhaps. And so this is World of Zool. So it's a text adventure where the game tells you things and you type commands to move around and respond and make different things happen within the little simulated world. And I'm actually going to open up the project and look at it briefly rather than just looking at their diagram here. So this is the first version of the project, known simply as Zool Bad, because it demonstrates a variety of things that benefit from improving. Let's see, so the main class, perhaps the biggest class certainly, is the class called Game. So here's a description of this class and kind of the overall thing. Very simple text-based adventure game. You're just gonna walk around some scenery, that's all. Really ought to be extended to make it more interesting. To play, create an instance called a playing method. Play method, this class creates and initializes all the others, creates all rooms, creates the parser, starts the game, evaluates and executes the commands the parser returns. So we've got create rooms here, which makes all the rooms and sets their exits. We've got play, which is the main play loop. We've got print welcome. World of Zool is a new, incredibly boring adventure game in its unmodified state. Process command, gets a command and handles it. Right now we've got basically help, go, and quit. Help gives us a little bit of some help text, and then we go room, they say go in a direction, we make the new room, whichever direction it was they went, and they try to tried to go somewhere. And then here's how we get them into that next room and print out the exits. So that's the game class. The room class, each room with a capital R, each room object represents a single room. Command words lists all the valid commands. Let's just go quick and help at this point. Parser. Prompts the user and gets the string that the user typed and breaks it down by spaces, asks commands if the first word is a command, and makes a command object if so, otherwise makes a null command object representing that they didn't give a valid command. And then command here represents each command. So command starts as a string in parser, and parser checks to see if it contains command words. If it does, or even if it doesn't, it creates a command object appropriately populated, which is then what the game class looks at when deciding what to do. So that's kind of our overview of World of Zool. So again, five classes. Game is the starting point, main control loop. Room is a room of game. Parser reads user input. Command is actually an enum that represents different possible new commands. It also has to check anything to check and see if something is a valid user command. And then command words. Command represents user commands as objects. Got them backwards, sorry for flipping. Just a second there. And command words is a list of recognized user commands. So, if we're going to evaluate code quality, if we're going to be critical of it and say this is good or bad, we need evaluation criteria. And two very important criteria for assessing the quality of code are coupling and cohesion. So, coupling refers to the links between separate units of a program, or the interconnectedness between different parts. So, we have two classes depend closely on many details of each other, we say they're tightly coupled. We aim for loose coupling when things are not tightly coupled. And looking at the class diagram, we can get some hints at the degree of coupling. So you can think almost of tight coupling as being sort of like this, where the two things couldn't really be pulled apart from each other without damaging one of them, right? So, coupling links between separate units, tightly coupled if two classes have been close to the main details of each other. We want things to be loosely coupled, and from the class diagram we can get some ideas about how coupled two particular classes are. So whereas coupling is relationship between different things, interconnectedness between different things, cohesion is the extent to which something is a single integral thing rather than, I don't know, a congealment of different things, perhaps. So cohesion refers to the number and diversity of tasks that a single unit is responsible for. If a unit is responsible for one single logical task, we say it has high cohesion. So if I am a sniper in a military unit, and that's what I do, is be a sniper, we might say that reflects high cohesion. But if I'm also the radio guy and the explosives guy and the commander, then I'm multiple different things, right? They're not closely related to each other. So unit responsible for one single logical task, we say is high cohesion. And we aim for high cohesion, whether we're talking about a class or a method or a module, the same concept applies. So a cohesive class has sort of one responsibility that it fulfills well, and it sort of all fits together in one thing. A cohesive method does exactly one thing and does it well. A cohesive module or package is a set of classes that handle in some way some single given responsibility and not other tangential things. So I try to come up with some sort of examples with the idea that cohesion is a thing being a single integral thing. We can think that a rock is very cohesive. Right, essentially a rock is a big thing made out of rock stuff. There's no obvious difference between different things in it. There's no sort of pieces. Whereas a bowl of spaghetti and meatballs with tomato sauce and cheese does not have high cohesion. It's different things that it's not clear comprise one single thing. That makes sense?
Yes.
So simplistically, we can think cohesion good, coupling bad. Or the way the book puts it is, how can we see high cohesion and low coupling? So here's an example that we can use to test the quality of the initial version of Zool bad. Suppose we wanted to add two new directions. To the game, up and down. What would we need to change to do this, and how easy are the changes to apply for it? And so you might think, well, okay, so command words has the different commands, right? So we'd add up and down there. Well, actually, command words just has the verbs, right? Mm-hmm. So then let's see, maybe let's start at the other end. Let's look at game. So if we look at game, so we've got all these calls to set exits in room. Those assume that there are only four exits. So clearly room will need to change to understand that it has more exits. So let's look at room first. So room will need two things here, it'll need another two things here, it'll need another two lines here. There's a fair amount of change in room, but not real bad. But if we look back at game, continue going through that, well, okay, so let's see. So we have to add in two things on each of these lines. Exits, we have to add in up and down as possible things here, right?
Mm-hmm.
In the print welcome, we have to add in up and down here, and then we have to add in up and down here again. So basically three places we have to increase what already looks like a pretty fair amount of duplication, right? And we have to change these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines, which could be easy to not notice until we got a compile fail, right? And then let's see, I think did we look at everything in room? So we'd have to change game, we'd have to change room. I think we may end up changing Okay, looks like those two. But the changes to game were significant, right? So we need to change a fair number of different things. And the changes aren't that easy to apply thoroughly. We saw there are lots of different places, right? In fact, the way I found them was basically by scanning through all the code and saying, does this line need to change? Does this line need to change? And because I sort of know the patterns of the way this thing works, I was able to do that fairly quickly. But that was really what I did. So that was not very easily done, right? It seems like it would be good if it seems like a good design would allow that to be done a lot more easily. In fact, a really good design would allow it to be done almost trivially. So that doesn't look so good. And indeed, we know it's named Zolbad for a reason. It's got a lot of issues as we go through the chapter. Now we're going to talk about designing classes. How do we design classes to avoid these kinds of issues that we've seen in the example? Coupling, cohesion, responsibility, and design. Okay, so first of all, reprise on what coupling is. It's a very important concept. Coupling refers to links between separate units of a program. If two classes depend closely on many details of each other, we say they're tightly coupled. We strive for loose coupling. And a class diagram can give us some ideas about the degree of coupling. For example, if we think back to the Zolbad diagram, we can see that game does interact with a lot of other classes, and so does command, possibly meaning there might be high coupling, but not necessary. Indeed, actually, when we do all the rework, we actually won't change the UML diagram we saw there at all. It'll still look the same. Class diagram so provides limited hints of degree of coupling. So, loose coupling. Loose coupling is what we want. Loose coupling is good. Loose coupling makes it possible to understand one class without reading others. Understand in Zool, we had to kind of bounce back and forth between different classes. We started in game, and that took us to room, then we went back to game. And makes it possible to change one class with little or no effect on other classes. So, we can see that loose coupling increases maintainability. It also makes development easier. And testing, which making testing easier improves maintainability a lot as well. So we try to avoid tight coupling. If we have tight coupling, changes to one class bring a cascade or sort of waterfall of changes to other classes. It makes it much harder to understand classes in isolation because to understand this thing, I have to understand this other thing that it's deeply intertwined with, like something that's graded maybe or something like that. And the flow of control between objects of different classes becomes complex. And that can be very hard to follow. Okay, so that was coupling. Reprise of cohesion. Cohesion refers to the number and diversity of tasks that a single unit is responsible for. The ideal case being that it's responsible for a single task that is just itself, or a very small set of tasks that are very closely related, right? So diversity of tasks would actually low cohesion if the diversity is significant. If each unit is responsible for one single logical task, we say it has high cohesion, which is what we aim for. And this is true for classes, methods, and modules. Classes should have high cohesion, methods should have high cohesion, methods should be just one thing, modules should have high cohesion, they should be about just one task than just one sort of problem. Any questions about that so far?
Well, I've gotten to the point on in the chapter and tinkering with Zool where I made, I added the hash map and made the changes, and did quite a bit of decoupling and made the some of the modules of the game more cohesive. And so I've got my own list of rooms with all their directions, and I even added a room that is a trap.
Oh, can't get out of it?
Yep.
Okay, nice. Yeah. And so it's really valuable to work through that stuff from Zool and see that. Because it makes so much more sense when you go through and do it. Just like we aim for low coupling, we aim for high cohesion. With high cohesion, it's easier to understand what a classroom method does because it's just one thing or some very closely related things. It makes it a lot easier to use descriptive names for variables, methods, and classes because they only represent one thing. You don't sort of use them for different things. And it makes it a lot easier to reuse classes and methods because once, for example, we have our unit guy who is just a sniper, we can move him to another unit and be a sniper there without worrying that means this unit also uses its command grade and radio man and logistics officer or whatever. It makes it much easier to do code reuse, which saves a lot of time for developers and a lot of money for organizations. It makes your job easier.
Which drives down the cost of software, which increases product demand, which drives the economy. So this is a good thing.
Yeah, there are no concerns about demand shortfalls here. Because that's just not something that's happening at all. So we try to avoid loosely cohesive classes and methods, ones that are just sort of very stuck and stuck together, like the initial version of the game. So we try to avoid methods that perform multiple tasks and classes that have no clear identity about what they do or what they're about. Cohesion at a class level means that a class represents a single well-defined entity. Cohesion at a method level means that a method is responsible for one and only one well-defined task. And so the class represents or is exactly what it is. The method does exactly what it's supposed to do, and nothing incidental thrown in that might make it harder to reuse or more complex to code or harder to understand and develop a sort of little representation of its useful. So there are the vernacular here is code smell. So there were certain things that programmers who are experienced look at and say, while it's hard for me to say for sure this is bad, it sure looks like it's probably bad. Code duplication is perhaps the strongest of those. So code duplication is an indicator of bad design. It makes maintenance harder and can lead to introduction of errors during maintenance because it's easy to not see all the different places you need to make the same change. So like in game, when we were adding up and down, there were three different places we had to do that, as well as those other six lines that were incidentally implicated. It would be easy to overlook any one of those. Indeed, sort of looking through those, you have to think, remember, think, oh, and why is it that we have to go through and do all these things again? Right. Code duplication is bad, and if we see it, we should assume that there is some design problem. If nothing else, just the maintaining of that duplicated code is expensive and makes bugs much more likely. For example, we might make a fix in one place and not in another, and if all our testing only tests the first place, we would notice the bug was even there. You know, it was only partly fixed. And now we had a much harder to find bug, much harder to find issue. So the other thing we were supposed to talk about in this area tonight was responsibility-driven design. So imagine the question, where to add a new method, which class? And the rule with responsibility-driven design is that each class should be responsible for maintaining its own data. And the class that owns the data should be responsible for processing. We can think then that, let me see how I put this previously. So, designing classes by assigning well-defined responsibilities to each class. One thing that every class is responsible for is maintaining and dealing with its own data. If we do that, then we will tend to have low coupling. You can certainly see how if a class is responsible for manipulating the data of another class, that would tend to lead to high coupling, right? Because there would have to be all these tendrils from the class doing the work to the class containing the data, potentially. Continue with a list of some other things to think about. One of the aims of responsibility-driven design and of reducing coupling is to localize change, meaning that when a change is needed, as few classes as possible should be affected. This makes it more likely for a change to be correct, and much easier to make our change, and makes it much less likely for us to add bugs while making those changes. So we want to localize change whenever we can, and we want to design our, we want to design our software in such a way that change is typically localized. We want to think ahead. When we're designing a class, we want to think what changes are likely to be made in the future and choose a design that would make those changes fairly easy. Does that make sense?
Yes.
One way of doing that is making it where the changes will be fairly localized. Oftentimes when we're maintaining code, we add additional lines of code, or replace some lines of code perhaps. But typically we end up adding code. And this makes classes and methods tend to become longer over time. Every now and then, classes and methods should be refactored to maintain cohesion and low coupling. In other words, as we're making the changes, we can think that some of the design itself sort of becomes obsolete, and we want to rework the design on the existing working code to better fit what the code does now and how the code works now. And this is called refactoring. And the key principle here is that for refactoring and testing, is that when we refactor code, we separate the refactoring from making other changes. So if we see that making some changes is going to make some refactoring necessary or worthwhile, first, well, we have two choices. One path we can go is to first do the refactoring only without changing the functionality and test before and after the refactoring to ensure that nothing was broken, and then make the functionality changes. The other path we could take would be to do the new functionality first and then the refactoring, but again, make sure that we test each time in between so that anything we break in one phase gets caught in that phase rather than making the next phase harder. So we could change the functionality, test it. First of all, test to make sure our tests are up to date. Change the functionality, test to make sure that new functionality works, and then refactor, and then test to make sure all the functionality, including the new functionality, still works. But we don't want to refactor and change functionality at the same time, because that means there's a lot going on in the code, and it's easy to make a mistake. And in particular, go back to the cognitive model here that says we can only fit so much stuff in our brain at once. And the more we're trying to fit in there, then the less brain space we have available to make sure the changes we make are correct. And so if we try to do both of these at the same time, messes tend to happen. But if we do them one by one, we can make sure that each one is done well. And the end result will be doing it a lot quicker as well. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Any questions?
No. I would see how, I think if we were ever a task that were set to me, I would definitely do refactoring before I changed any of the functionalities, because if you, potentially if you add the functionality first, that might entirely change how you would then have to refactor, if you, as opposed to doing the refactoring first and then implementing the changes.
Well, so if we think about Zool, for example, and Zool bad, we could go through and add those new directions first and then refactor how exits and rooms work. But we can see that it'd be a lot easier to first do the refactor and make it where rooms own the concepts of exits and room prints or return strings representing their exits and some other things like that. And then once we've done that, it's much easier to add up and down.
Yeah, because then you go through all the work of adding up and down, and then, oh, well, we want to make this better, so let's change how it
Right, so the reason to do refactoring first, I forgot about that, it should have been clear, is by doing the refactoring first, we wouldn't have to deal with up and down twice. Whereas if we do up and down the old way, so adding new functionality first and then refactor, then we have to sort of deal with it twice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so first refactoring is indeed the best way to go. Any other questions?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, there are some common questions that people might ask, especially new programmers. How long should a class be? And how long should a method be? Well, now we have enough concepts that we can give a pretty good answer to these. questions using the ideas of cohesion and coupling. So a method is too long if it does more than one logical task. In other words, if it's not cohesive. A class is too complex if it represents more than one logical entity. It doesn't necessarily mean two logical entities, it might just be a logical entity and a half, right? And so in that case, the class would not be cohesive. Mm-hmm. So we can think about these questions in terms of cohesion or cohesiveness, and once we do, the answer is pretty clear. Now, having said that, when these are good guidelines, they are only guidelines. There's still quite a bit of choice open to the designer in determining what the best design really is. It may be that doing a single task, single important logical task, makes for a method that has great length, and you decide that you want to break that up into pieces, even though it is one logical task. It might be that two logical tasks are so closely intertwined that if you try to implement them in separate methods, you end up bouncing back and forth between them a lot for some reason. And maybe you decide, well, the right design is to just do them in one method rather than having that high degree of coupling between these two distinct methods. Any questions about that? So, just to review some important points, programs are changed essentially continuously. We must make this change possible if our software is to survive and be useful. And so what that means is that for code to have quality requires a lot more than just performing correctly at one point in time. We test it and it works, so okay, that means it's good. Code must be understandable and maintainable. Good quality code avoids duplication. It displays high cohesion. Each thing is one single thing. It displays low coupling. There's not a lot of tendrils between two things that make it hard to separate them or tease them apart if you want to reuse one somewhere, or even just understand them, right? If they're closely intertwined, we can't understand one without understanding the other, and vice versa, right?
Yeah. And looking at the initial Zool-Bad game, seeing it makes it very difficult to easily discern exactly how that object functions when it's handling tasks that should have been designated to run to begin with.
Yeah.
It
makes
it very confusing.
Indeed. Hard to read and hard to code correctly because of that. Coding style, including commenting, naming, and layout, is also important for making your code accessible and making it easily comprehensible to yourself, even while you're working on it. So there's a big difference, indeed, a huge difference, in the amount of work required to change poorly structured and well-structured code. Organizations have started thinking about poorly structured code that they possess or depend on as technical debt that they owe. So by not putting in the work to do it right the first time, they have borrowed from the future and now sort of owe that debt that sooner or later they're going to have to pay. And the most problematic part there is that it's not necessarily a scheduled thing, because maybe you just need to fix some bug that seems like it should be simple, and you trip across this existing debt, and because of that, it's really hard to fix this bug, right? And so you may end up making lots more payments on this debt than you expected, and at times when you didn't have the time, money, investment, whatever. And so organizations are trying fairly hard these days to avoid ever having or depending on poorly structured code so that they don't have these issues. Or even go back and rewrite the code. It's hard, maybe because they have to figure out what the code does, and that's hard to do because of how poorly written it is. And so even replacing the technical debt piece, you may have to pay the debt to replace it, which is a little counterintuitive, but I'm not sure about that. Any questions?